past. There's a connection that we need to keep. It's a part of the heritage. It's something that we're losing. It's something that needs to be saved. And I come here to hear the language, to hear it from the woods once again. It's just a connection to the roots.
Yeah. Greensky Hill. We're going to get us set up with Matt's flute for our prayer time, and then we'll greet each other. Wave to your neighbor while I'm doing this. Good morning. I'm Reverend Jonathan Mays. I'm the pastor of Greensky Hill Indian United Methodist Church. If this is your first time joining us online, welcome. We can't wait to have you here in our 180-plus-year-old hewn log sanctuary in the woods near Susan Lake here in Charlevoix. And we can't wait for that time. And speaking of waving to your neighbor, you're doing that in your imagination this morning. Well, you can physically do it, but we'll only see each other in our imagination. But next week, the first Sunday of October is October 4th, and it's World Communion Sunday. So we are going to have our first drive-in communion service and parking lot FM radio sermon. Sarah's doing the sermon. I'm doing the communion, and the schedule's a little bit different because I have to be on Mackinac Island for a wedding next weekend. So 9:30 to 10 is drive-in communion here in the parking lot. And I'll have you drive in. We're going to have food boxes. It's family food boxes from the Manna Project. And we've got plenty, so come on. If you need any food, we'll be able to give you a big box of food with non-perishable items that will last you for a little while. We've got 5 packs of cotton masks, face masks for this time when we still need to be loving our neighbor that way. So we've got those available. We can give each family several packets. We have many of those. And we're going to be passing out home worship packets for our friends who can't join us online. So will you help me? If they get more than one call, I'm sure they won't mind hearing from you. But let's reach out to all of our elders who have not been able to participate online and make sure that they know there's drive-in communion next Sunday morning, October 4th, World Communion Sunday from 9:30 to 10. And then they can stay in the parking lot if they want to and wave to their neighbor from a safe distance. Hopefully we'll have a warm day like we have the last few days, and people will be able to have their windows down. We'll park cars at least 6 feet apart, so that should be safe. And we'll be able to hand out home worship packets for the last quarter of this year so that people who can't join us will be able to follow the same scriptures and say some of the same prayers and think some of the same thoughts that we're thinking so that we can be a little bit more together apart. Last week in Exodus 16, we talked about manna. And we appreciated Derek Weber's thought. He wrote, "Manna, that's what we're celebrating. Manna in the wilderness. Sustenance for the journey. But also a question. Manna, in Hebrew, translates as what is it?" And on this last Sunday of September, this morning, we're continuing our September worship series through the wilderness with Strike the Rock. It's another Moses story. It's a great story, and Sarah's going to be here to share her thoughts for the kids on that. And I brought this beautiful painted, we use it as a talking stick or a child's walking stick that Kathy painted with the life cycle of a butterfly from the larva to, or the egg to the larva to the chrysalis and finally the butterfly as my staff to strike the rock with today when we read that story. And the service is all about nibi, the Anishinaabemowin word for water. It's all about water. Janann Cornstalk shared a resource this morning on our Greensky Hill group page on Facebook for a day without water. It's coming up in October, and it's a day for us to think about and act on what it would be like to have a whole day where we had no access to clean water, as many of our global neighbors experience all the time. So today, this service is all about nibi and the gut honest question. Gut honest, maybe one you've been asking yourself. is the Creator among us or not? And at the end of the service, we're going to borrow a little bit of hope, a little glimmer of hope, from the David Wilcox song, Show the Way, when we sing, In this darkness, love will show the way. And I want to thank Mary Phillips for leading me to this song that we're going to share together. Weber's notes about today's text, Exodus 17, are also helpful as we get ready to worship together. What if the theme for this week, strike the rock, becomes a call for deeper living? Strike the rock means find the joy, even in difficult moments, even in the wilderness. A couple other announcements as we walk through this wilderness together apart. Our Zoom coffee hour begins right at 11. You can check here on this group page for an invitation, and you should just be able to click the link, but the password is there if you need to copy and paste the password. We talked about World Communion Sunday next Sunday from on October 4th from 9:30 to 10, drive-in communion and all of those other resources. And then Sarah Schaefer, Pastor Sarah, is going to be sharing a sermon next week from here that will be broadcast not only on Facebook Live, but in our new FM radio station that's just local to Greensky Hill. You'll be able to tune in and listen in the parking lot. And don't forget, council members, that we're meeting on the Susan Hall porch next Thursday, October 1st, this Thursday, October 1st, at 5 o'clock and via Zoom, and you'll get an email about that. We've met that we might worship. Let us worship God in spirit and in truth. As I ring the bell, I encourage you to look around for a rock and strike it with a spoon or something that makes noise. No, kids, it's not okay to strike your sister or brother with a spoon, even though you think their head is as hard as a rock. That's not okay. Same thing, moms and dads. But find something, at least symbolically, to strike a rock hoping for water, because we're thirsty. And if you can, light a candle, as I light candles for us as we begin worship. Perfect metaphor for what we need from each other right now. One of our candles is struggling. In fact, both of our altar candles are struggling, even though there's still candle in there. I checked it this morning. I don't know what that's about. But the light of Christ is strong, and we can give light to one another when we can't be light for ourselves. We've been praying together. You can find a daily anti-racism prayer every weekday on our Greensky Hill Facebook page. And we've been using one of those every Sunday to help us as we think about our BIPOC neighbors and what they need from us to live a whole life and to experience the promise of wholeness that the Creator intended for all of us. We're we're going to sing an opening song, Lord, whose love through humble service, that will remind us of our role of being both light and love in the world to show the way, and also that it's okay to be the one who needs that extra support right now. And then we'll hear from a psalm. Actually, let's do the psalm first. This psalm is a hymn that was written thousands of years ago for the Hebrew people, and it retells the story of Exodus that we've been spending our time in during this Through the Wilderness series. And it's a great way for us to begin our recentering, to remind us that we are not the center of the universe, but the one who is loves us. Psalm 78, give ear, O my people, to my teaching. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth in a parable. I will utter dark sayings from of old, things that we have heard and known, that our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their children. We will tell to the coming generation the glorious deeds of the Lord and his might and the wonders that he has done. In the sight of their ancestors, God worked marvels in the land of Egypt, in the fields of Zoan. God divided the sea and let them pass through it and made the waters stand like a heap. In the daytime, God led them with a cloud and all night long with a fiery light. He split rocks open in the wilderness and gave them drink abundantly as from the deep. God made streams come out of the rock and caused waters to flow down like rivers. The words to this hymn, Lord, whose love through humble service, are in your Facebook order of service. If you're getting used to this online practice and haven't tried it much yet, we always print an order of service that you can print out if you need to, or you can just keep another screen open while we're worshiping together. Will you sing this with me? It's not bad when I'm all alone in my living room figuring this out, but when you're here with me, it's a little bit different. Let me figure out the melody again. You know what, folks? I can't figure it out. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to punt, talk amongst yourselves for a second, maybe find a rock, and we're going to use some musical help. This is where I miss Sharon Osterhaus more than even usual. She's our accompanist, and they're doing well. But we have decided it's not quite safe to be in the same space together singing yet. So you get me. Most of the time, I can figure it out. Okay, ready? That also gave you a little time to find the words, so I won't be singing all by myself. Here we go. You'll see how I almost found it with the guitar, but not quite. Well, that was worth it. Still your children wander homeless. Still the hungry cry for bread. Still the captives long for freedom. Still in grief we mourn our dead. Well over 200,000 right now. As, O Lord, your deep compassion healed the sick and freed the soul, use the love your spirit kindles still to save and make us whole. Join me, please, in praying a prayer for wholeness. It begins really uncomfortably, let me warn you. It's taken right out of the Gospel of Luke, chapter 18, verses 10 through 14, where the righteous, self-righteous religious leaders put on a show instead of humbling themselves to be real before God. So this prayer starts like this. It's called Going Home Justified. Naamaadaa. God, I thank you that I am not like other people, that I am respecting of property, know to stand before our nation's flag, protest the right way. Sure, I think racism is bad, and if I ever met racists, I'd gently show them the error of their ways. I'm glad I'm not like those people who are violent and angry. They are making things worse than better. They should just be patient. They should be more like me. God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I am scared and broken and afraid. I might be part of the problem rather than the beginning of a solution. Forgive me looking at the method of protest before listening to the reasons behind it. Forgive me for assessing who has a right to be angry, who has a right to speak or take a knee instead of trying to understand what brought them to their knees in the first place. Give me grace to listen deeper with compassion, like that of the one who had compassion on me, a sinner. Let's take that spirit of prayer continually before the Lord as we think of all of our other needs, our needs for healing, our needs for fellowship, our needs to be able to touch each other and see each other. Our need that this pandemic come to an end. And all of the things that are on your heart this morning. Sarah's here with me. We're praying with you. Your siblings are joining all over the world via Facebook Live, not only in this moment, but later today online. And we're praying together. This is a real connection. Let us pray.
the Lord's Prayer. Nous nam spinning ein. Manu dachitoen jade dishnikas. Dugmau in the gustum gadanen mundeshoabat ama king. Dvishko udishpin. Mishanam sumugadishka gagan jang. Gye abuen mishnam mumbataj. As Abuen Madwa Egiwe, Metu Dog, Eje. Egevish Kangama, what when dog swimming, Nebogamushnam dish, Unje Ama, and Jay Ewish. He marked the band down, Ogama Owen, Gexke Elsun, Gepsigam Dogsum, Gognik upon a Gognik. Amen.
Just before Sarah comes to share a children's message this morning, we're going to collect our offering. And when we do, you know, there is a lot of grief in the world right now. There's a lot of dark emotions, a lot of hardness in the world. But there's also so much joy. And so much laughter. So that we can offer our offerings with joy, I'm going to invite you to think about something that happened this week, maybe even this morning, that was so ridiculous, and maybe even so private that you wouldn't dare share it with anybody else, but it made you laugh uncontrollably. And if it didn't happen this week, just think back. Our kids were sharing with us some ridiculous things that happened that maybe you don't normally laugh at, but we need to laugh right now. And they actually could not catch their breath. They were laughing so hard. That releases such good chemicals in your body when you do that. And it's part of getting up every day and facing what we have to face. So when you think about that, think about something that made you laugh. As forgiven and reconciled people, let us offer ourselves and our gifts to God. And let me thank you for so faithfully sharing your gifts on our PayPal link, and that's found on our website and on the Facebook link, and also by mailing them to the check. We've been receiving them. They're getting to our treasurer, Trish, and getting to the ministries that they need to support. Thank you so much. Let's sing our doxology. Church, help us to see the things that really matter. Places where we can provide for others in need and deepen our trust in you to take care of us. This we pray in the name of Jesus, our rock, from whom comes Nibid, the water of life, and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, I'm going to put my, I guess we have a subtle butterfly theme this morning. Kathy's walking stick has the butterfly life cycle. Sarah, feel free to use this as a prop if you need a staff. I'm going to put on my papillon, that's French. I'm really sophisticated. For butterfly, I only know that because of a movie by that name. And let Sarah pass so we can hear a children's message.
Well, good morning.
Good morning.
I also brought a staff this morning, so though mine is not as large and beautiful as this one is, I did bring my own. So we won't joke about, you know, which one is going to work better, but for demonstration purposes, you know, maybe I should use the big stick this morning. How many of you have played rock, paper, scissors?
I have.
We still have played that game even as adults, maybe to as a fun way to settle an argument or to get to, you know, be the one to pick where we're going to dinner. But the premise of the game is, you know, you put your hand out and have a platform, and you use your other fist and you say rock, paper, scissors, and then you can say shoot or you can say go. And when you say that, then you create a rock with your hand, or you create scissors, or you create paper. And of course, as we know, the rock can smash the scissors can cut the paper, and the paper can cover the rock. So, or you can tie. And so this morning, I thought it would be fun if we played some rock, paper, scissors. Now I know you're all at home, and I'm not gonna know if you're really playing, but I hope in your heart that you're really playing rock, paper, scissors with me, because we're gonna see who can win a best 2 out of 3, okay? And Pastor's in the back and he's getting ready to play. So everybody get your hands ready. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Oh, we tied, we both got rock. Rock, paper, scissors, shoot. Oh, I got it. All right, rock, paper, scissors, shoot. And I got it again, okay. Well, anyway, we didn't plan that out, but thanks for letting me win. So we've got a rock, we've got some paper here, and we've got some scissors. And the great thing about rock, paper, scissors is that when you're playing, you can change your answer every time, and you could win any of the rounds. You don't have to always be the rock. You don't always have to be the paper. You don't always have to be the scissors. And it's just kind of a fun way that you can just kind of change things up and guess. And you know, these items that you play with, they're really useful. Like if you're going to write a letter, you know, paper is going to be super useful for you. Probably not the rock or the scissors, you know, aren't going to help you to be able to write a letter, but you could use that paper. And let's say that you needed to cut some string or some rope. The paper and the rock are really not going to be helpful for you, but the scissors will be great if that's the task that you need to do. And if you're thirsty, you know, scissors and paper are not going to do anything for you, but, you know, you could totally get a rock and get some water.
Absolutely.
Wait, what? A rock? Okay, wait a minute. In our lesson today, we learn how Moses, who was leading the Israelites out of captivity, and they were thirsty, and they were upset, and they said, you know, we're not going to survive. And as we know, we need water to survive. We need to have water every day. And when you're really thirsty, you can get dehydrated, you can get, you know, body aches, and you can get dizzy, and there's all these things that can happen to you physically when you don't have water. And these people were experiencing that, and they're saying, Moses, we need water. What is going on? And so Moses had led all of the people out, and he didn't have water to provide for them, and he went to God. And he cried out to God, and he says, God, I need to help them. You know, you need to help me, please. He fell on his knees, and he said, you know, we need to bring them water. They are thirsty. And God said, I'll tell you what. You go and get your staff, whether it was this one, hard to say. But you go ahead and get your staff, and you get some of the elders in the church, and you go ahead out to the great big rock and gather all of the people, and you take your staff, and you hit the rock. And when he did that, he didn't know where this was going, but he trusted God. When he hit that rock with his staff, water came pouring out, and not just enough water for the people, but for all of their animals. And there was plenty of water for everybody who was thirsty. And, you know, when we hear these kind of stories, they really kind of sound impossible. You know, we think, oh, well, that kind of thing just happens, you know, in the Bible, and, you know, those are just kind of impossible, you know, miracles that have happened. And sure, there were big miracles that were documented and things like that, where if we were to go out and take a stick today, we probably wouldn't be as successful hitting a rock and making water come out. But when we do have issues that are smaller, when we are not literally, you know, thirsting for our own lives, when we have thirst in other ways in our lives, God will provide for us. And so we just need to remember that we can trust God, that if we have a God that can create water out of a rock, then he can certainly hear our prayers and answer our needs and help us when we just feel like there is nowhere else to turn. So let's pray. God, thank you so much for providing water to the Israelites who were thirsty and in the desert. Thank you for reminding us to turn to you when things seem impossible. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oh, I think a good part of our congregation is old enough to get this reference, and the rest of you, you can Google the Tonight Show with Johnny Carson. But Sarah, every time, whether it's here when everybody's here or on Facebook Live, that she does her children's message, I feel like Ed McMahon because she is so animated and she makes me laugh, and so I can't help but respond. And people just hear off screen this, whoa, whoa, whoa. This is fun. Ed McMahon used to do that with Johnny Carson all the time. Bye, Johnny.
Bye,
hey, aren't we incredibly blessed to have Sarah Schaefer as our children and families pastor? So thankful for Sarah. And you know, I'm thankful for you. Paul wrote to churches that long before Twitter and FaceTime and Zoom and Facebook Live, when we're far apart, sometimes much farther apart than Paul was from the churches that he was writing to, he wrote letters because he couldn't be there in person. And those letters, we now have many of them in this library of stories about our Creator that we call the Bible. And Philippians is one of those letters, and we'll be closing our service with a way to strike the rock that really does produce living water. So while Sarah's completely accurate that most of us will not go out and into the wilderness and stand on in the desert and strike the rock and have water supply come bubbling out for the people, there are thirsty people, literally thirsty people, in this world right now. And one of the ways that we can strike the rock is to do our part to make sure there's clean, accessible water for everybody. There is enough. There is enough water in this world right now. There's enough food in this world right now. It's a matter of political will and the will of the people to say that that's where our resources should go instead of into war and political campaigns. Can you imagine if we took all of the money that's spent to get elected to office, even the legal money that's spent, let alone the under-the-table money, can you imagine if all that went to feeding people and making sure people had clean, accessible water? We're going to sing A Fountain of Life and Grace, I think. I don't know what's happening with my music this morning, so we're not going to sing that. We will next week. It's a beautiful hymn from our Ojibwe hymnal, and we will get to it next week. We're just going to move right into our scripture story for today. We've been in the book of Exodus, as I shared, and that's where the theme, through the wilderness, comes from. And this morning, we're talking about the story that Sarah just shared, And let me read it to you from the 17th chapter of Exodus. And it's just seven verses. And I hope you hear some actual practical ways that we can still do our own version of what Moses does in this story. It might not look as dramatic. I promise you, if you give life to somebody in any way, it's going to be as dramatic for them as it was for the people in the desert who got water when they were thirsty. Here's the story. From the wilderness of Sin, the whole congregation of the Israelites journeyed by stages as the Lord commanded. They camped at Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink. The people quarreled with Moses and said, "Give us water to drink." Moses said to them, "Why do you quarrel with me? Why do you test the Lord?" But the people thirsted there for water, and the people complained against Moses and said, "Why did you bring us out of Egypt to kill us and our children and our livestock with thirst?" So Moses cried out to the Lord, "What shall I do with this people? They are almost ready to stone me." The Lord said to Moses, "Go on ahead of the people and take some of the elders of Israel with you. Take in your hand the staff with which you struck the Nile and go. I will be there in front of you on the rock at Horeb. Strike the rock and the water will come out of it so that the people may drink." Moses did so in the sight of the elders of Israel. He called the place Massah and Meribah because the Israelites quarreled with the Lord, saying, "Is the Lord among us or not?" If you're looking for a biblical name for your next child or grandkid, may I recommend that you not name them Massah or Meribah because they mean test and quarrel. And this was a quarrelsome people. Oh my goodness, they were a quarrelsome people. Last week in our story in Exodus 16, we were left with the bitter complaining of people who actually found what they needed. They complained because they didn't have enough to eat. And God did a similar miracle through Moses, bringing quail and manna every night. It was like dew on the ground, but when it dried, it was like a flower of some kind. And they could make something edible out of it, and it sustained them. Excuse me, Kathy and I were watching Zac Efron's Into the Earth, I think it's called. Really fun, encouraging, also, Netflix documentary. And we learned that if you have one potato and one egg, that's enough to sustain daily. If you have one egg and one potato, that's enough to sustain you for the rest of your life. I told my brother that, and he said, "I would not survive that." He would just stop living if he was stuck with just one egg and one potato every day. But the point is, we don't need a lot of actual food, as long as it's quality food, and especially local food, to sustain us. We definitely nibid. We need water. Water is life. And without it, we understand the people's complaining. As Nancy Hastings Sehested wrote, about this moment when they've already been given food, but they've moved on to another place in the desert and they don't have enough to drink. There's not enough water. Part of it is because the water from the sea they're not in that region anymore. And what do you do with salt water? If it's a lake, but your enemy has been killed in that lake and the water is no longer drinkable, what do you do about that? If you're out in the desert and you can't find enough water, or if you're any place in the inner cities of America right now, and the infrastructure is corroding to a point that you are in danger of poisoning your own family, like the families in Flint were poisoned by our failed government to make water a priority, our government who failed to make clean, accessible water a priority, what do you do about that? Well, one thing you're going to do is cry out to God. Nancy Hastings Sehested wrote, that the Hebrew people were not chronic whiners complaining about the food service. They were desperate people faced with annihilation. No wonder they asked, "Is the Lord among us or not?" The slaves thought their liberation from Egypt would immediately plop them down in the Promised Land, but God's first freedom act was deliverance into the severe and harsh wilderness. Perhaps only in the land of hopelessness could God hope to see a people let Pharaoh go and embrace the God of life. Wilderness provides the necessary time to rid oneself of having someone other than God name and define you. Let me share her thoughts again. Wilderness provides the necessary time to rid oneself of having someone other than God name and define you. Now, you've heard me often enough if you've been a part of this church before, and in case you haven't, let me say it loud and clear. COVID-19 is not God's judgment on humanity for anything. God doesn't do things that way, in spite of what some people try to teach. They pick their favorite sin, usually something, quite often something they're actually personally struggling with, but because of their religious authority, they can't acknowledge that. They make it a sin so bad that that's all they talk about, and then they blame naturally occurring events, some of which are destructive, on that sin of those people. And that's really terrible theology. That's a really terrible way of seeing God. What God does do, what our Creator is faithful to do, is when we suffer the consequences of our own actions, and when there's just evil in the world, not evil in the sense of that active racism, like me individually doing harm to a person of color, but systemic racism, and evil in the sense of the life-taking things that happen in the world. That's pervasive. And it's a part of the human condition. What God is faithful to do is to be with us in that and to give us something, give us new life from it. It's not the same as making something happen to us so that we learn a lesson. Please get that clear in our minds. God help us get that clear in our minds. COVID-19 is not didn't happen to us because we needed to learn a lesson. It is happening, and in it, in this wilderness of COVID-19, we have the time, the necessary time, to rid ourselves of having someone other than God or something other than God name us and define us. True liberation delivers us from all that binds us, Nancy Sehested wrote. It delivers us from all that binds us, diminishes us, and enslaves us. This holy word springs from God's ever-flowing freedom fountain. It was the word from Jesus offered to the societally defined and disregarded Samaritan woman in my favorite Bible story, the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman, for whom Jesus broke all of the rules just to have a conversation. And in that conversation, he said to this woman who had been wrongly condemned by her own community, "Whoever drinks from the water that I shall give will never thirst. The water that I shall give will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." Brothers and sisters, siblings, Derek Weber offered this thought to bring us to some action this morning before we sing our closing song. Striking the rock is trusting that there is a way forward when it seems like there is no way. Striking the rock is a declaration of faith, even when it seems like giving up makes more sense. What are we to do when distrust, skepticism, and giving up seem to make more sense than trusting? What are we to do? Remember the stories. Tell our stories. Teach them to our children, in our hearts and lives and in community, even when community happens together apart. Remember the pattern we've seen in Exodus 17, the story that we just shared. Ask the honest questions. Is the Creator among us or not? And listen without judgment when others are asking. And then cry out to the Creator. What shall I do? What do I do, God? Are you there? What do I do? And then go on ahead. Don't just be trapped. Don't be immobile because of all the things that challenge us in the wilderness. Go on ahead and take other leaders with you. Trust that God will be standing there in front of you when you get where you're going. And then strike the rock. And what does that look like? What does striking the rock look like when we're not talking about literally bringing water from a rock, but bringing life from hard things? It looks like a day without water. That moment that's coming up in October that Janann Kornstock shared on our Facebook group page. Please follow the link. Imagine a day without water is the event that's coming up in October, and you'll find the date and the information there. It's a day to pause and notice the way that water systems impact our lives and our communities, and commit to ensuring a sustainable water future for generations to come. These are things I know are important to our green team. Their mouth is watering right now, thinking about what we can do. You can join them. Turn on the tap and clean water flows out. Flush the toilet and dirty water goes away. With a little soap and water and two rounds of the doxology or happy birthday, viruses are annihilated. When you have a reliable water source, you don't have to think twice about the infrastructure that brings water to your home and then safely returns water to the environment. But we all should. The reality is America's water infrastructure is deteriorating as it gets older. And there are even communities around the country that have never had access to the infrastructure in the first place. On Imagine a Day Without Water, we ask everyone to consider what their day would be like if they couldn't turn on the tap and get clean drinking water, or if you flushed the toilet and wastewater didn't go anywhere. What would that be like? That's striking the rock together, apart. What are some other ways that we might strike the rock together? I'm going to invite you to share your ideas of how we can bring life in the middle of this wilderness, big and small ways. Share those ideas with one another in the comments. And we'll close with this beautiful song from David Wilcox. And I'm so glad that Mary Phillips invited me to learn this song and listen to it. I shared his version, and it's beautiful, and I hope you get a chance to listen to it. But sometimes, striking the rock is just having the courage to take one more step in the right direction. And these days, it can just be getting up on our feet and doing our best. You say you see no hope. You say you see no reason we should dream that the world would ever change. You're saying love is foolish to believe, cause there'll always be some crazy with an army or a knife to wake you from your daydream, put the fear back in your life. Someone wrote a play just to glorify what's stronger than hate. Would they not arrange the stage to look as if the hero came too late? He's almost in defeat. It's looking like the evil side will win. So on the edge of every seat, from the moment the whole thing begins, it is love who makes the mortar, and it's love who stacked these stones, and it's love who made the stage here, although it looks like we're alone. in the scenes set in shadows, like the night is here to stay. There is evil cast around us, but it's love that broke the plague. For in this darkness, love can show the way. So now the stage is set. Feel your own heart beating in your chest. This life's not over yet. So we get up on our feet and do our best. We play against the fear. We play against the reasons not to try. We're playing for the tears, burning in the happy angel's eyes. For it's love amidst the mortar. And it's love who stacked these stones. And it's love who made the stage here. Although it looks like we're alone. In the scene set in shadows, like the night is here to stay. There is evil cast around us, but it's love that wrote the play. For in this darkness, love can show the way. Show the way. Show the way. In this darkness, we're not alone. We're together apart. If you can find a way to be safely together, distancing and looking after one another, don't miss that opportunity. That's another way to strike the rock. But please continue to practice all the precautions. This thing is not over yet, but love wrote the play. Life is right in front of us. Let's recognize it. Everything we long for, everything we need is right here. Together we have enough. Enough food, enough water. The kingdom of God on earth as it is in heaven is among us. Let's come back home. Let's join the notorious RBG and fight for the things that we care about, but do it in a way that will lead others to join us. Find a rock to strike this week. Invite some kin to join you. In this darkness, love will show the way. Paul talked about it in his letter to the Philippians. And I invite you to just hear this. Don't try to analyze it. Just hear it and try to do it. Go on ahead, trusting that the Creator will be there before you. If then there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. Though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself. I need you. You need me. We're all a part of God's body. It is God's will that every need be supplied. You are important to me. I need you to survive. You are important to me. I need you to survive. I pray for you. You pray for me. I love you. I need you to survive. I won't harm you with words from my mouth. I love you, I need you to survive. I need you to survive. It is God's will that every need be supplied. You are important to me, I need you to survive. You are important to me, I need you to survive. Go in peace to love and serve as Jesus loves and serves, and strike some rocks along the way. Amen. Facebook group page. I'll join you as soon as I get home. You can go ahead and start meeting. I hope